Okay, let me talk a little bit. Got to fly high and just do some general things. I wasn't sure how to go about this when you're doing a subject as broad as the prophets in one class, but I hope that there'll be something here worthwhile. Prophecy, it's a revelation of God delivered in written or spoken words by a human being acting under the inspiration or the control of the Holy Spirit. Okay, that's what prophecy is. This definition, you can see it, it's implied in the statement of Micaiah, the son of Imlah, when he responded to the suggestion of the king's messenger to agree with the unanimously favorable answer of the king's prophets. Mary says, you know, they're all saying this, why don't you go ahead and join them? And Micaiah's response is, as sure as the Lord lives, I can tell him only what the Lord tells me. You see, this is what a prophet is. Someone who is delivering God's revelation in, you know, acting under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, delivering it in written or spoken words. And you see that in 1 Kings 22:14. Now in 2 Peter 1:21, he says, for no prophecy ever was brought by the will of man. Rather, men being moved by the Holy Spirit spoke from God. See, that's why this is so important. This is God speaking. This isn't the word of man. This isn't my word, somebody else's word. This is, prophecy is the word of God. And that puts it in a completely different category. Now, this isn't to deny that God sometimes delivered his message through the symbolic actions of the prophets instead of through a spoken or written word. He does do that sometimes. For example, in Ezekiel chapter 12, Ezekiel acts out the exile that was going to come upon the people of Judah. See, it's only to point out that prophecy in its strictest sense involved verbal communication. The word of God, spoken or written. Now, Moses is called a prophet because God spoke through him. You can see that, for example, in Numbers chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 14 to 20. God speaking through Moses, he makes clear that a prophet is his spokesman. That's what a prophet is. He says, I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers. I will put my words in his mouth. And he will tell them everything I command him. If anyone does not listen to my words that the prophet speaks in my name, I myself will call him to account. So this is what prophecy is. This is what a prophet does. A prophet is a conduit of the word of God. He is God's messenger, and that's very critical that we understand and appreciate that. Now, the Spirit's role in prophetic inspiration is apparent in the Old Testament. It's apparent in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, for example, in Numbers 11:25, the 70 elders prophesied when the Spirit of God rested on them. In 2 Chronicles 15:1, 20:14, 24:20, it's said that the Spirit came upon the prophets when they prophesied. The Spirit is the one through whom God is using the prophets to speak his words, to communicate his message. Ezekiel reported in Ezekiel chapter 2, verse 2, that the Spirit entered him when God spoke to him. Micah declared to Israel its rebellious acts because he was filled with the Spirit of the Lord. Micah chapter 3, verse 8. Zechariah condemned the people for rejecting the word that the Lord had revealed to them through the former prophets by his Spirit. Zechariah chapter 7, verse 12. 1 Samuel 10:10, Saul prophesies when the Spirit of the Lord comes on him. He prophesies then. 2 Samuel 23:2, David declared that the Spirit of the Lord spoke through him. Hosea 9:7, the prophet is called the man of the Spirit. And I already read to you the 2 Peter Chapter 1:21, up there. Men being moved by the Holy Spirit spoke from God. Prophecy is one of the gifts of the Spirit in the New Testament. So you see the role of the Spirit. In Acts 11:28, the prophet Agabus predicted through the Spirit that there would be a severe famine that would spread over the Roman world. And in Acts 21:10, the Holy Spirit spoke through him in predicting Paul's upcoming treatment. So we see that the prophet is the person who delivers God's word, delivers God's message. He does that under inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Here are some titles that you see of Hebrew prophets, of Old Testament prophets. Being spokesman of God, it's not surprising that prophets are referred to as God's servants. I mean, they're serving God. Why? Because they are delivering God's message. And you see various texts there that use that reference. Sometimes they're given the title man of God, because again, they are being moved, they are being used as vehicles of God's revelation. So they're referred to as man of God. Prophets are also called seers. They're called seers. That was especially true in Israel's early history. You see that in 1 Samuel chapter 9, verse 9. They're seers. You say, well, what does that mean? I can see that in terms of seeing the future. But they're seers because they're given by God insight into the past, present, and future events. You see, they're seers in that God gives them insight into not only the future, but into past and present events as well. Now, the main term that's used of prophets in the Old Testament to refer to a prophet is the Hebrew word Navi. And see, that's the word. It's translated prophet. Now, the origin of that word, where that particular Hebrew word comes from, it's much debated, but the essential idea behind that word appears to be an authorized spokesman. So it's somebody, I'd say here, you speak on my behalf. So that seems to be what is behind the Hebrew term Navi. Now it was translated, that word was translated prophetes in Greek, which is of course where we get our English word prophet. Okay, the Hebrew word Navi was translated prophetes, and that comes over into English as prophet. Now before, there were prophets before. You see, prophets before the prophetic books of Scripture. You know that. But there are prophets before you have the writing prophets, before the prophets who are involved in the prophetic books of Scripture. God was speaking to mankind through certain persons, prophets, long before the prophetic books of the Old Testament. The earliest of those books probably goes back to the 8th century B.C., whereas Abraham, who lived some 1,300 years earlier than that, he's called a prophet in Genesis chapter 20, verse 7. So the writing prophets go back probably just to the 8th century, beginning in the 8th century B.C., but long before you have God speaking to people through persons, through prophets. Many other people, men and women, prophesied prior to the 8th century B.C. Some of them aren't named. There are a number of them who are named, but some of them aren't named. Moses and his sister, the prophetess Miriam, lived in the 15th century B.C. Deborah, another prophetess and a judge. But Deborah lived during the period of the judges, which you remember that predates Saul's anointing as king, and his anointing as king was around 1051, and the period of judges is those centuries before that. So she's functioning as a prophetess during that time. And the prophet Samuel, he lived on both sides of Saul's anointing as king, on both sides of 1051, but still long before the 8th century, where you have prophets functioning. Nathan, Gad, Ahijah, they all prophesied in the 10th century B.C. And you have others as well. Now, the rise of the monarchy, the rise of the kingship, this had an effect on the office of prophets. You see, with the anointing of King Saul in 1051, remember Israel wants a king, and now we have a monarchy, we have a kingship. That brought a new dimension to the prophetic role. And what happened is that prophets, often they delivered God's word to the king. You see, now that we have a king, well, you see prophets very often delivering God's word to the king as a way of keeping him accountable to God. He is God's servant. He's not above God. I don't care how exalted he is, how high of a position, you know, that he's been put into. He's held accountable to God. And they were God's voice that often comes and confronts him, confronts the king, and keeps him accountable. One thinks of David and Nathan, King Ahab and Elijah, Hezekiah and Isaiah. You see these prophets functioning this way very often. See, the prophets, they stood outside of the theological and moral corruption of the society. A corruption that was fueled to a large extent by the king's evil influence, and they proclaimed God's word to all guilty parties. To the king, to the priesthood, to the false prophets, to the people. So they are standing out here. You have this very influential king who's working his evil influence in the society, and they come to the king, as powerful as he is, but they serve God and they speak on God's behalf. You talk about speaking truth to power. This is what they did. They spoke truth to the king, to the people, the priesthood, everybody. And they would deliver God's message to the people. Now, other than Moses, the two most significant prophets before the 8th century, before the writing prophets, the two most significant prophets are Elijah and his protege and successor, Elisha. They're the two most. They prophesied during the 9th century B.C. So about a century before we get the writing prophets. That's when we have Elijah and Elisha. And they set the pattern that some of the later writing prophets followed. They set the pattern that you'll see in some of the later writing prophets. And as J. Daniel Hayes says in his book, The Message of the Prophets, a confrontation with the king and other ruling powers. There's a call to repent and return to faithful obedience to Yahweh, and warnings of judgment on those who fail to heed the voice of Yahweh. And we'll see that as the common themes of the prophets. But here you have Elijah and Elisha really kind of setting the table and setting the trend that they would come and bring this word to God and say, you are violating God's will. You are living in rebellion against the covenant, and you must repent or bad things are going to happen. And you'll see this again throughout. Now, the prophetic books of the Old Testament, you see the writing prophets. In English Bibles, you're familiar with the collection of writings of the prophets. They begin in the English Bible arrangement after the Song of Solomon with four large books: Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel. So we have the prophets grouped together after you have the poetical books, after the Song of Solomon. We have the small book of Lamentations, which is associated with Jeremiah. That's stuck in there between Jeremiah and Ezekiel. And despite the fact Daniel is sometimes classified as apocalyptic rather than as prophetic, and despite the fact that Lamentations is included merely because of its association with Jeremiah, those five books here are commonly called the major prophets. Okay, those five books are commonly called the major prophets. They're followed by 12 smaller books. So we have the major prophets, and then they're followed by the 12 smaller books, commonly known as the minor prophets. And as I always say, they're minor not in importance. That's simply an indication of their size. So you have these larger prophetic books with Lamentations put in there in the association with Jeremiah. And then you have these smaller prophetic books grouped that are called the 12, those 12 minor prophets. Now the Hebrew Bible, it's arranged differently. It has the same books, but they're arranged differently. In the Hebrew Bible, the major divisions, you have law, prophets, and writings. And the law part is exactly like the English Bible arrangement. But they then bust up the prophets into former and latter prophets. And when it says Samuel, it includes first and second. You see, when it says Kings, it includes first and second. When it says Chronicles, it includes first and second. So you have these four former, and then over here we have the latter prophets, which are Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and called the Book of the 12, which is the 12 minor prophets. Okay, so that's how they divide it up. And then so you get law, prophets, and writings, and that's where you get the Hebrew scriptures. When they talk about the Hebrew Old, well, they don't call it the Old Testament, but the Hebrew Bible, they refer to it as Tanakh. And that's an acronym coming from these sections, Law, Torah, Nebi'im, and Ketuvim. So Tanakh. And so that's where they get that from. And then the writings are divided into these subsections here, these subdivisions where you have poetical five rolls or five scrolls and historical books. And Chronicles, Second Chronicles being the last of the Hebrew scriptures. Same books, but they're arranged differently. Now the prophetic books of the Old Testament, they cover a span, a time period of roughly 300 years, from about 760 B.C. to about 450 B.C. Now, some of these things, especially the minor prophets, are difficult to date. You see, they're just not easy. But generally, that's going to be close from about 760, maybe you could push back a little bit, down to about 450, roughly 300 years. Now, during those years, the ancient Near East was dominated by three successive kingdoms. You have the Assyrians, then you have the Babylonians, and then you have the Persians. And so during that time of these prophets, you have a shift in dominant world powers in the ancient Near East from the Assyrians to the Babylonians to the Persians. The Assyrians being from 745 to 612. 612 being the when they were defeated at Nineveh by the Babylonians. Babylonians going from 612 down to 539 when they were defeated by the Persians, when the Persians took Babylon. And the Persians going from 539 down to 336 when Alexander the Great came on the scene. So you have these three successive world empires. Now, though some of the minor prophets, as I say, are very difficult to date, here's a chart from J. Daniel Hayes' book, The Message of the Prophets, that sets the prophets in their historical context in terms of those three successive world empires. Now, unfortunately, it omits Obadiah, which I think was supposed to be here, because we have Joel with a question mark here, and I think this was supposed to be Obadiah, but somebody had a brain cramp. Because Obadiah is typically dated in the 6th century, sometime after the fall of Jerusalem. So let's just pretend that that's Obadiah, that second Joel there. So here you see where the prophets are located historically there. As I said, the Assyrian city of Nineveh, that fell to the Babylonians in 612. That's why they date that as the shift from the Assyrian Empire to the Babylonian Empire. And you notice that Daniel spans both the Babylonian period and the period of Persian dominance. See, he was carted off into captivity in 605 BC with the first Babylonian deportation. And then he continues into the Persian period by at least several years. So he spans both of them. And Jeremiah, he gets an asterisk because he also spans two periods. He begins his prophecy in 626 BC. So that puts him right at the tail end of Assyrian dominance, but the vast majority of his prophetic activity occurs during the Babylonian period. Okay, so this is when we have Jeremiah and the other prophets here situated in terms of the what's going on in the world, in terms of the dominant powers that are at work there in the world. Now, the fact a book is named for a particular prophet doesn't mean that that prophet personally wrote the book. You see, that doesn't have to follow. And it doesn't mean that he put the book in its final form. Jonah, for example, is a book that's written about Jonah. Right? I mean, it's all about the third person. This is what happened to Jonah. Jonah did this. And you see the same thing in the first part of the book of Daniel. It's about Daniel, what happened to Daniel. So it doesn't mean that they wrote the book or wrote the book and put it in its final form. Now, the fact that God inspired men to put the message that he delivered to the prophets, that he inspired other people to put that message into its final form for later generations, the form that he intended it to be in when it would be incorporated into its holy scriptures, that does not in the least threaten the conviction that the writings were inspired by God and thus are inerrant. You see, sometimes people, it has to be actually written down. No, it's based on the prophet. It's based on the prophecies that he delivered, but God inspires other people to take that prophecy and to use it in delivering a message to other people, to shape it. And they are no less inspired than was Luke when Luke investigated. You remember Luke goes and investigates things beforehand? Well, what happens? Well, Luke goes and investigates, and then all of that work and all of his personality and all of his training, God has superintended all of that so that when Luke takes in what he's looked at, when he brings it to paper, it is exactly what God wanted written. Okay? Exactly the words that God wanted written. In other words, inspiration, it's a much broader concept than simply God pouring words into somebody's ear. That's how you see the differences when you look at you see stylistic differences. It's not all flat. It's not all the same. Why? Because God has reared up and is using somebody who has a different style to present what? He'll bring up poets. You see? And they'll, why? Is that because that's them? No, that's them as trained up and given by God so that they write exactly what he wants written. Okay, I just want you to see it, because sometimes people say, well, this has to be, there's no reason to be concerned about later development and shaping and editorializing in preparation of what was given to the prophets so that it is now God's message to a later generation of people. Okay? So that sometimes happens, and I think we can see that. Now, the standard pre-exilic prophets, at least in the terminology that Hayes uses, they are prophets who lived before or during the exile. Okay, so if you prefer, you want to say pre-exilic / exilic. But they are prophets who lived before or during the time of the exile, which is 587/586, with the destruction, the fall of Jerusalem, and 539, when the Persians conquered the Babylonians. And then right after that, the Jews were allowed to return home. Okay, so that's the period of the exile. And pre-exilic / exilic prophets are those who live before or during that period. Post-exilic prophets are those that live after that. And as I said, Daniel spans both. You see, he's post-exilic by several years, but he's also pre-exilic. Now, there's much variation in the details and the circumstances of the pre-exilic prophets, but most of them share some central themes. And I didn't know any other way to do this. You see, most of them share some central themes. And here is how J. Daniel Hayes summarizes the themes of the standard pre-exilic prophets in his book, The Message of the Prophets. Now, I say standard pre-exilic prophets because they are three non-standard pre-exilic prophets that I'll say something about in a minute. So they don't really share these themes. But the standard pre-exilic prophets, those prophets who lived before or during the time of the exile, before or during 587, 586, 539. Okay, here is the common themes that you see in them. You, Israel or Judah, have broken the covenant. You had better repent. No repentance? Then judgment. Judgment will also come to the nations. Yet there is hope beyond the judgment for a glorious future restoration, both for Israel / Judah and for the nations. You see these themes coming up repeatedly in the prophets. Now, the sins or the covenant violations that commonly were charged against Israel and Judah, they fall into three major categories. They are charged with sins in the area of idolatry. They are charged with sins in the area of social injustice, and they are charged with sins in relying on religious ritualism. Now, there are other things, but these are three main categories that you see coming up over and over again. You see them: idolatry, social injustice, or the rich are abusing the poor, cheating them out of justice, and you see in religious ritualism. See, after exposing their sin, the prophets wind up calling the people. They come and they lay it out before them and they say, here's what you're doing. You're doing these things. And then they call the people to repentance, often pleading with them to return to God. They come out and they say, look what you're doing, how unfaithful you are to the covenant. You must repent. Come back to God. And they often wind up pleading with them, return to Him before it's too late. Come back, come back. And you see that function. Now, the prophets reminded God's people that safety and blessedness were conditioned upon their faithful adherence to the covenant. Their faithful adherence to the covenant, and that this adherence, it involved not only doctrinal conviction. You see, faithful adherence to the covenant involved not simply knowing and believing the right things, but also a sincere submission of their will to obey God with their whole heart and to lead a godly life. Always you're seeing this, the connection between faith and life. And anybody that splits that doesn't know what they're talking about. You see this always, the conviction, the connection between faith and life. Apart from submission of will, submission of life, no amount of sacrifice, no amount of ritualistic worship can satisfy the Lord. He says over and over, this is nonsense, it's disgusting to me. If you wind up living in rebellion to me, living like you are God and I am not, rejecting what I want for your life and treating me like I'm a joke, and then you come into some kind of cultic or ritual context and you want to worship me and you think I care about that? Worship, see, requires the predicate of a surrendered life. All acceptable worship comes from the predicate of a surrendered, committed life. Then it's pleasing to God. Then it's an aroma to God. But a rebel who comes and offers God worship, do you think that's what he's after? He's after you and your worship in your submission. And you see this over and over. Gleason Archer says in his book, A Survey of Old Testament Introduction, he says, this is perhaps the foremost emphasis in the prophets. Bring no more vain oblations. Your hands are full of blood. Cease to do evil. Learn to do well. Come now, let us reason together. It is not that the prophets regarded moral living as the essence of religion, but rather they understood a godly walk to be the unfailing product of a genuine saving faith. They recognized that all men were guilty before God and utterly without hope apart from His redeeming grace. No one could be saved by his own virtue or goodness. But on the other hand, Israel needed to be reminded, as does the professing church in modern times, that God would accept no substitute for a sincere faith which expresses itself by a law-honoring life. By submission to the will of God. That is not petty. That is not legalistic. That is honoring God by showing Him, I live for you because you've done so much and because of who you are worthy of so much more than my life. That's what it is. It is living a life to honor God. And then we come together and worship people who are His, who are given to Him. You see? That's why the church has to be, you know, has to be serious about sin. You see, so we don't just, I don't care. You know, you want to live with your girlfriend, live with your boyfriend, you want to be drunk, you want to do these things. I don't care. Just come on in. You know, God loves everybody. God does love everybody, but he expects everybody to love him. Right? All right. He expects everybody to love him. And so this is what we're doing, and this is what the prophets say over and over again. Here's what Jesus says. This is Jesus on loving God. You know all these texts. But I just pulled out several. We could have looked at some in 1 John 2. Or 1 John also. He says, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. In 14:21, whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me. Jesus answered him, if anyone loves me, he'll keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words. So don't give me this divorce of submission and obedience to Christianity. Divorce it from your life. Oh, I believe that's all that matters. That's all that matters. I want to keep living the way I do. I want to be God of my own life. I want to do the things that I know God tells me are wrong. I don't care what he says. But I want to trick myself into believing that somehow that matters to him. If I come to church and do this, that'll take care of it. I'm telling you here as plain as I can that that's a lie. Okay? As plain as I can say it. That's a lie and that's nonsense. God calls you to a crucified life. And in that context, we worship him. 15:10-14, he says, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I've kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Okay? This is what prophets are saying. When Israel treats God like he's a joke, the God who rescued them, who created them, who protected them, who blessed them, who's given them everything, and then they treat him like you wouldn't want to be treated as a parent. When they disrespect him and treat him that way. Well, the prophets, he sends the prophets to them to call them. You need to repent. Because if you don't repent, judgment is coming. Judgment is coming. And you see this happening over and over again in the prophets. Now, when Israel and Judah ignore the pleas of the prophets, they tell them repeatedly that the consequences of their arrogance and rebellion and hard-heartedness and stubbornness, that the consequences of that is going to be a devastating judgment. And here's just one text I picked out because it always gives me shivers. Jeremiah 19:3. You shall say, hear the word of the Lord, O kings of Judah and inhabitants of Jerusalem. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I am bringing such disaster upon this place that the ears of everyone who hears of it will tingle. He said, what I'm going to do is going to be so shocking, so breathtaking, so devastating. And I'm telling you, and I'm giving you a chance, and I'm begging you to repent so that not happen. But if you stay in your stubbornness and in your rebellion, I will bring a judgment that will be so devastating that when people hear of it, they're going, oh, whoa. And those who were here in our study of the book of Lamentations, you know that he did that. That's what the book of Lamentations is about. It's an afterlook. It's after the destruction and looking back and saying how absolutely horrific it was. And God had told them and he had promised them. But the prophetic message, it often carries a hope of future restoration. There is this message, this hope of future restoration. The prophets encouraged Israel with respect to the future, in the face of the divine wrath on Israel that's coming because of their stubborn disobedience, the question arose whether these judgments are going to mean the absolute end of Israel as a holy nation, a nation set apart to be a witness to the pagans of the one true God. Is that it? Are we through? And the prophets would often assure them that after the devastation of the exile, after the destruction of Jerusalem that's recounted in Lamentations, this horrible destruction, after they're uprooted and pulled out as God had promised them, and he had begged them repeatedly to stop treating him the way they were treating him. And so when he takes them into exile, into Babylonian captivity, and their lives are miserable, and their capital's destroyed, and all of the suffering that came as a consequence of their rebellion, the prophets assured them that after the exile, a believing remnant would be restored to the land. It would not be the end. This wasn't where the story was ending. It may look like it's where the story's ending. And if you were one of the people who'd had your family killed, or you're over here in captivity, uprooted, living as an alien in a place where they think you're a dog, that's not exactly a pleasant existence. Well, you may think, yeah, it's over. But the message of the prophets had this note to it. You see, that there is a future. There is a future. The nation, you see, would that there would this believing remnant would return to the land, and the nation would fulfill its destiny as a testimony to the Gentiles and the coming of the Messiah. See, under the leadership of the Messiah. And that's why, see, when you see that the church, I've said, is Jewish at its root. You see, who is this true Israel? All of the people who came to Jesus were Jews. Right? The early church, the nucleus of the church, showed that we believe the Word of God and we've cast our lot with His Son who has come. We are the children of Abraham because we have the faith of Abraham. So all of the apostles, all of the early church, Jews. And what happens? Gentiles get grafted into that. You see? The Gentiles get grafted into that. But the church is Jewish at its root, fulfilling that mission. See, so this encouraged them. This message of the prophets encouraged them to keep trusting in the Lord. An image is painted in the prophets in culturally relevant symbolism of a future state brought about by God that will be breathtakingly grand. It's given to them in pictures they could relate to. But the image is of a state brought about by God that would be breathtakingly grand, a state of peace, joy, and glory that transcends fulfillment within history. When I say within history, I hope that communicates. I mean, it's going to be a fulfillment that transcends life the way we have always known it. There's going to be a degree of discontinuity. It's not going to just be same old, kind of buffed up. You see, there's going to be continuity, but there's also going to be a degree of discontinuity. And he paints this picture of this grand, breathtaking state. And these are pointers, you see, of the coming kingdom of God. That's the vision that's behind these prophets of this kingdom of God, this great, glorious state. And he drops these things all through the prophets of what he's going to do. You see, and that's this great state. You see, this is the healing of the broken creation in which the faithful of God will share. You know, we're following the story. The story began with a creation, a perfect, good, wonderful creation. It began with disruption, a fall, and we've been waiting and see how the story plays out. Well, in the prophets, you see, where is it going? As in Isaiah, it's going to a new heavens and a new earth. You see, it's going to a new heavens and a new earth. Same terminology that Peter picks up. You see, so you see these things put out there. You see, this is what they were longing for. This is what the Jews of the first century were longing for when Jesus entered the world. They were waiting for this, expecting it, anticipating it. You see? Though Jesus came, but he had to correct some misunderstandings they had about the kingdom. But that's what they're waiting for. And it's in that context that when Jesus comes and he says, the kingdom of God is at hand. Ah, well, you see, that comes in that context. Well, we've been waiting and waiting for, when is God going to set everything right? When is he going to do this? And he comes in and says, oh, you see why this was a buzz. You see, this is why there was such talk going on. Now, the non-standard pre-exilic prophets, using Hayes's categories, you have Obadiah, Nahum, and Jonah. Now, they didn't, let me go back to his little chart. You see, they didn't contain, their message doesn't contain the standard message delivered by the other pre-exilic prophets. They're a little bit different, you see, in that Obadiah and Nahum, they preach only against foreign nations. They preach against Edom, and they preach against Nineveh, and they bring a message of God's judgment on the enemies of Israel. You see, now there's a message in that for us. You see, this is how the Bible is. The Bible is, you first have to see what was God saying to the original audience, and then we hear that, and then we say, okay, now what is God saying to us today through what the Spirit inspired them to say to the original audience? But you have to hear it first that way before you jump to what it means today. That's part of what happens with the Bible and why it gets butchered. Is people don't take the time to say, what is the message that is being said? And then you're in a position to say, all right, what is God saying, the Spirit of God saying to us today through that message? Okay, so that's, you see that Obadiah and Nahum, they preach there. Now, Jonah also involves Nineveh. But Jonah, interestingly, it indirectly carries a rebuke and an invitation to Israel and Judah to repent. You remember, Jonah goes to Nineveh, and there are a lot of things in Jonah, and Jonah doesn't want to go and all that, and Jonah's bummed that they're repenting. He doesn't like that. Well, there are messages in all of that. But one of the things is, you see, the challenge to Israel and Judah is, do you not see this pagan nation that on hearing my word repents? Why don't you? Why will Nineveh, when I send a prophet to Nineveh, Nineveh will say, oh, we need to turn to the Lord. He's God of all. But you won't. Why should Nineveh receive my blessings when you are my people and you're not interested in them? Okay, so there's a very powerful critique of Israel and Judah here in the message of Jonah. But it is different in that it's a message that's given, that's delivered, takes place in Nineveh. Now, the post-exilic prophets. Okay, the post-exilic prophets, we have Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. Well, they address the discouraged and disillusioned community that was in Jerusalem after the return from Babylonian exile. You see, they had hoped for the ultimate great restoration. These ideas that are sprinkled in the prophets and that are everywhere of the complete restoration. God is going to heal the broken creation. It's going to be this ultimate, glorious time of joy, peace, patience, all of that. Glory, where we live in a perfect reality. And so when they return from exile, not so much. You see? And so they're bummed by that. Because this is what they're hoping and expecting. And they look at the temple and they say, yeah, you know, I see the temple, but boy, it really can't hold a candle to the old one. And look at all the minor prophets calling the people to repent of their sin. This isn't a time of glory when sin's been eliminated. They're just abusing people and doing all kinds of stuff. So you see, they start to say, well, this is more same old, same old. I'm really glad we're back and we really, you know, we come back to God and wrestle and struggle. But they see that it is not the ultimate thing, you see. It's not that ultimate fulfillment. See, what they'd hoped would be the great restoration pointed to in Scripture was turning out not to be that. And these prophets, what they did, they urged the people to faithfulness in their circumstance while suggesting that the ultimate restoration, God hasn't given up on that. It's still future. It's still future. You see, and see, so they're waiting for it. This is hundreds of years later in the first century. They're waiting for it, and here comes Jesus. The kingdom of God is at hand. Ooh! Really? Now it's coming? Yeah! Kingdom of God! I'm the one! I'm bringing the kingdom of God. The ultimate state. And there are complexities with that. And I've talked about them many times, about the now and the not yet and all that. But Jesus ushers in the kingdom of God. Now, since Daniel's going to be addressed on August 3rd, and I've roped Anthony into teaching that, I really would like to teach it, but I'm not going to be here, and that's all I'll say. Was that the second bell? Oh, well, there you have it. There are a couple other themes that I wanted to mention from Gleason Archer, but there you have the prophets in 43 minutes. Thanks.